The Titanic is, after the Ark, the most famous ship in history. The difference being the Titanic is real. When I think about other famous wrecks, from the Mary Rose to the Endurance, from the Lusitania to the Bismarck, the Titanic is the only one that actually haunts us as a society. It is the quintessential Greek tragedy in miniature. It was not a warship or casualty of war, but one that slid silently into disaster and confronted its passengers and crew with the reality that their lives would most likely end in just a few moments. Most of us know the story. The brand new liner, touted as the largest in the world with the label unsinkable attached to it because of new technologies and designs that meant that if several of its watertight compartments were suddenly breached, she would still remain afloat. The reality was that there were not enough lifeboats on board, and in the sea being nearly flawless, the ship was speeding headlong into an ice field in an effort to get around it quickly. And it slammed into an iceberg, which loomed out of the darkness, and it slid along the side, rupturing rivets and splitting into one watertight compartment too many, causing them all to feel like an ice cube tray, dragging it slowly down by the bow. Of over the 2,200 passengers on board, only about 750 survived. And the angst of knowing that the Californian lay just 10 miles away and could have rescued so many more still frustrates us. There's that feeling of pathos as the passengers and crew face their end. This week, Seekers, we're discussing Gareth Russell's The Ship of Dreams, The End of the Edwardian Age. Now, there are a ton of books out there on the Titanic, but I really highly recommend this one because it approaches the disaster from a different perspective. Russell is actually an Irish writer who has written plays and other nonfiction books. And in fact, this was originally in the British version called The Darksome Bounds of the Failing World. I kind of like that one. In any event, this book went on to be the Times Book of the Year. Now, Russell actually follows six passengers to illustrate his point that the Titanic was the first step in ushering out the age of the aristocracy, with World War I being the final closing of that door. He focuses on the Countess of Roth, Thomas Andrews, the Strausses, John Thayer and his son Jack, and an American actress by the name of Dorothy Gibson. Yet, it's not just following them around the Titanic during the trip. He gives a lot of biographical background to help give these people a realism that is sometimes lost in dry histories. It reminds us that these are people who were experiencing normal for them, but it's colored by maids and the peccadilloes of their class. We learn that Anders, the great builder, was actually homesick for his family and didn't really want to be on the trip, but it was expected that he go. We learn about the Strauss family connections to the pre-Civil War era and their transition to a New York family. So instead of giving us a dry description of the ship and its features, Russell takes these people through the journey, with the details being background color. He also puts these people in context of their society, showing us about the rise of the Irish Home Rule and the decline of the British aristocracy. We learn about their displacement by American industrialists, especially in the aftermath of the Tsar's assassination in 1881. Another strength of this book is the moments when he debunks legends and myths and conspiracy theories about the sinking. The nature of the steel, the ship had suddenly been replaced by the Olympic at the last minute for some kind of insurance fraud scheme, and other such nonsense. I also appreciated his efforts to debunk the notion that the third-class passengers were trapped or locked below and that there was a giant effort to suppress their survival and focus on the upper class. He points out that when one actually crunches the numbers, third-class women survived on par with the other classes, and that the disparity was gender more than class. I think I really appreciated this book because of the focus on the biographical. Now, I've read other biographies, such as the one on Ismay, which was pretty good, and I enjoy this approach because it becomes, to me, more realistic. These are real people, not extras in a James Cameron movie. They were all going through life in their way, and then their world was shattered. Russell brings a fresh look at a disaster that many of us know by heart. And as I've said in a previous video, our family has always been fascinated by the Titanic and its agony. So I really appreciated this book and what it provided. Join me next month for our next Read Harder Challenge, The Promise by Damon Galgut. I think I'm saying that right. It's a family saga to celebrate Mother's Day, although I won't do the review until May 25th. Follow me on Twitter at ToddWorld3 while you still can, before Musk destroys it, and see what other books I'm reading. Join me as I talk about them among my rants about the collapse of civilization as we know it. Hey, if you've read this book, let me know what your thoughts are. Did you like it? Did you not like it? Let me know what you think about the Titanic and if you're a fan. Anyway, peace to y'all, and I'll see you next time.